الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. And sisters, welcome to the concise presentation of the fiqh. The topic for today is the Oaths and Vows, chapter 9, page 519. Today is episode 80. Before we proceed, just to say the date, today is the 6th of Dhul-Hijjah, 1445 after the Hijrah, and it's Wednesday, the 12th of June. 2024. Oaths and swearing. The definition, the word for oath is yamin, plural, ayman. It originally refers to one's hand because when swearing to an oath, they would take each other's right hand.
I think the chapter titled Oaths and Vows. Did you say that? No, Oaths and Vows.
In Islamic law, it refers to emphasizing something by mentioning the name of Allah or an attribute of Allah.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa mawalah. Amma ba'd. This is a new chapter, which is actually a chapter, call it from the practical chapters, because it's something that we use day and day out. Should make it an oath. The oaths is everybody. I mean, maybe once a day you make an oath by Allah. Also, it's to do with the vows. So it's important to learn this issue. Right, let's meet everybody here. Right. So we're coming to the oaths. We say with the definition of that, it says that is to, in the Sharia, is to emphasize something by mentioning Allah's name or the sifa. So one of the names of Allah, Allahul Hakim, Ar-Rahim, Allah, Al-Qadir, Al-Khaliq, Al-Razik, or one of his attributes, like the might of Allah, the face of Allah, the speech of Allah. Those are the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal. So you can make an oath by that, as we're going to see in details, inshallah. Fine. Go ahead.
How an oath is made. An oath is not made except by swearing by Allah, one of his names or one of his attributes. Abdullah ibn Umar narrated that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came to Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, while he was riding his mount and swearing by his fathers. The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, certainly Allah has forbidden you from swearing by your fathers. Whoever is to swear an oath must swear by Allah or remain silent. Anas ibn...
That's it. Right. So this is the first hadith that he brings. Hadith Abdullah ibn Umar regarding his father when he was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What do we learn from this hadith? This hadith says, Umar Khattab, he was going with the Prophet of Allah, a particular journey, and he started making an oath by his father, يَحْلِفُ بِأَبِيهِ. So the Prophet ﷺ addressed people, saying, Allah, verily, Allah forbids you from making oaths with your fathers. Here, أَبَائِكُمْ, that means fathers and grandfathers, great-grandfathers. And he who wants to make an oath, then let him make an oath by Allah, or let him be quiet. He who wants to make an oath, then let him. So this is let him, which is like a, when we have a prohibition and then you have a command, it shows you that it is permissible. It's a principle you have to learn. So if there is something prohibited and there is a command, then it shows it is permissible. Verily, I have prohibited you from visiting the grave. Verily, visit the grave. This is not a command to go and visit the grave. It means it is permissible to visit the grave. Do you understand that? So when there is a prohibition, they don't visit the grave before it was, and then now I used to prohibit you, but now visit. Now, it doesn't mean I must visit the grave. Do you understand me? It is permissible. So he said, don't make an oath by your parents, fathers, and if you want to have an oath, let him have an oath. But it is not a must upon you that every day I have to make an oath by Allah Azza wa Jal, or let him be quiet. We learn from this, first of all, that when the person prohibits something, it is from the etiquette is to show the alternative. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, do not make an oath by your parents, but make an oath by Allah. So he gave you the alternatives. When the Prophet ﷺ also, he said to, also Allah ﷺ, he said, لا تقول, he said to the Jews or followers of Musa ﷺ, لا تقولوا راعنا وقولوا انظرنا. Don't say راعنا, but the alternative is انظرنا. And also we have the Jewish person came to the Prophet ﷺ and he's saying, you know, you are good people, but you make shirk. Not the Jewish, who is a mushrik, he is saying to the Prophet, you're good people, the Muslim, but you're making shirk. He said, how come? Prophet didn't say that. You are a mushrik. You're telling me I'm a mushrik. He said, well, what is it that you say? He said, verily, you say, wal Ka'bah. By the what? By the Ka'bah. And that's shirk, by the way. Can't make shirk. I can't make an oath by the Ka'bah. So this Jewish man, he said that you are making an oath, Muslim, by the Kaaba. And the Muslims at that time, some of them, they used to do that. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, he didn't say to him, we don't take our knowledge from somebody, mushrik like you. No, no, no. He took on that on board and he said to the companions, if anyone of you want to make an oath, let him not to say wal Kaaba, alternative now, but to say warabbul Kaaba. By the Lord of the Kaaba. Should it change now? So he gave an alternative, and always the alternative is to be not far away from the one that you are prohibit, something close by. So give him an alternative. Don't say, so by, you say, by the Lord of the Kaaba. Secondly, that the story did not emphasize whereabout was the journey and how Umar was there, because the focus is not on the journey. Where is the focus about the, when is the trouble or what is the trouble? The focus is upon the whole thing that the Prophet of Allah is saying to the one, Umar al-Khattab, who had made an oath by other than Allah, my father, don't make that. So this is the focus. Focus, what we learn from this. It's not the focus upon where is the journey. So Abdullah ibn Umar did not say and narrate to us what was that journey. Thirdly, we benefit from this that, and I mean, the second benefit it means, when you mention something, go to the point. Don't mention something that would distract the people. Go to the point, the thing that you want to teach the people. Third thing that we learn here, Aba. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, do not make an oath by Aba. So we know that from this word, Aba, it means the father, the grandfather, okay? So the grandfather in the Quran is called also what? Ab. Okay? Grandfather is called Ab. So he's a father, father of the father, he's a father. Okay, so that is as well another benefit. Fourth benefit here, that looking at the fathers with sheer reverence, it was known at that time. That's why they make oath by their fathers. And it is something which is that the people, you know, it's from their trend. It's from, it is, this is their habit. They uphold their parents to be esteemed, you know, the high. That's why he said by our father. That's why he had, you know, made an oath by somebody who he reckons to be something which is magnified or I would say exalted. And also here there's a benefit that the Prophet ﷺ was keen to forbid the evil. The evil here is to make an oath by other than Allah. And Umar al-Khattab does not mean to make his father equal to Allah. He had made shirk lafzi, shirk in his words, but not shirk in his heart. No way Umar al-Khattab meant to make the father of his or the grandfather of his equal or above Allah Azza wa Jalla. Also, another thing that he says that we could benefit from this hadith, that he who is ignorant, didn't know and said something or made a mistake out of ignorance, then he should not be reprimanded or rebuked individually. I mean, he could have just told Umar al-Khattab like this. No, but he told the people, all of them, do not make an oath by your parents, but make an oath by Allah, okay, the Lord of your parents. So here, Prophet Allah addressed everybody. He did not rebuke him because he was what? He was ignorant. He didn't know. He didn't have the knowledge of Umar al-Khattab. Also, that we find here that everything stays as on the default unless there is something to change it. Meaning here, Umar al-Khattab, he made an oath by his parents because this is the default. He hasn't been taught something else. So he stayed on that default until somebody had said to him, no, that default needs to be changed. You cannot stay on saying by your father. Also, we learn that when we have a great issue like this, it has to be emphasized with some of those things that would drag the attention of the people. So he said, the Prophet of Allah said, Ala, verily, inna Allah yanhaakum. Okay, so he didn't say, I forbid you. So, no, ah, verily, by Allah. So he's making the other Prophet, this is something great. I'm saying, by Allah, Allah is forbidding you. He didn't say, I forbid you. Verily, by Allah, Allah is forbidding you. Ninth thing as well, that is to make the oath upon something which is permissible, is permissible. Well, the Prophet said, if you want to make an oath, that means permissible, as long as you make it by the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these benefits, we extract them from hadith Abdullah ibn Umar about his father. Now coming to the following hadith, hadith Anas. Tafadhal.
Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hellfire will continue to say, is there more? Until the Lord of power puts his foot over it. Then it will say, enough, enough by your power. Then its sides will be brought close to one another.
So here the Prophet made an oath by your power or by your might. Give you another word. Izzah means might. Is this what? Name of Allah or an attribute of Allah? The might. It's an attribute. It's not a name of Allah. Okay? Izzah. He didn't say Al-Aziz. Al-Aziz is the name of Allah. But Izzah is the might, the power. Al-Aziz, the powerful, the mighty. So here he made an oath by the might. So the hellfire, it said wa'izzatika, by your might. Okay. So we understand now that the oath is to be made by the names of Allah. Like, for example, Ar-Rahman, by Rabbil Alameen, Al-Hayy, Alladhi La Yamut, Walladhi La Ilaha Illa Hu, Walladhi Nafsi Biyadi, by the one in whose hand is my soul. This is all of it names of Allah Azza wa Jal. Once you make the oath by a name from the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, that your yameen, your oath, is being considered an oath. And if you haven't fulfilled that oath, then you have to expiate. But if that name that you have used, that it is not just a name would be to Allah, but only it will be to Allah if it's left alone by itself. But if it is going to be, there is an indication that there is not Allah is mentioned, then if he had made it with his intention and he made it not mutlaq, without specification, then it is an oath. But if he did not intend and that Allah Azza wa Jalla intended something else, it will not be an oath. For example, Al-Khaliq, the creator. The creator can be given to him. You are a creator. You create mobiles. Okay. So if he said Al-Khaliq like this, it goes to Allah, but he has to have the intention. So the intention with it. If he didn't have intention, he meant Al-Khaliq means the manufacturer. Okay. Al-Khaliq. Al-Razak, the provider. The provider, your person, the boss, provides you with a salary. So if he said that by the provider like this, and your intention is Allah, your oath will take place. But if you did not have that intention, and you said Wal-Razak, and he meant by somebody else, not the Almighty, it will not take place. And also Wal-Rab means the Lord, by the Lord. And the Lord could be Allah, or it could be the Lord of the house. Okay, so on and so forth. But if this name that you have used, normally it is the case, it is not, if it's left alone, then it will not be directed to Allah. So it will not be a yameen, an oath, except if you have meant it to Allah Azza wa Jal. For example, Al-Hayy. Al-Hayy, the one who is alive. I mean, everybody's alive. Everybody's alive. So it could be Al-Hayy, he's Hayy, Al-Hayy. Or you're alive, you're alive. So we said, Wal-Hayy, it could be Allah, it could be anybody in Allah, regarding, it could be this or that. The difference between the first one, Al-Khaliq, Al-Khaliq, when you say Al-Khaliq, the creator, your mind comes to Allah. But Al-Hayy, it could be anybody who's alive. So Al-Hayy, or Al-Alim, Al-Kareem, the noble, the generous, there are lots of people generous, huh? Al-Generous. So when you say Al-Generous, Al-Kareem, not everybody who goes to his mind to Allah, not like the Khaliq, Al-Razak, the provider, the creator. So, as an oath, that if you said, Wallah, There's no such thing, you know, that did you mean somebody else? Because Allah is Allah. Wal Rahman, man is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is Allah azza wa jal. So if you had the intention, straight away becomes an oath. Okay, have the intention, becomes an oath. So the intention is important. If you don't have an intention, even if it's by Allah, if you don't have an intention, it will not make an oath, as we're going to see. Also, we said to make the oath by the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay, the attributes of Allah. So the attributes of Allah, that for his might, it says, wa'izzatika, then the oath would take place. But as for the attributes of actions, then if the intent is Allah, then it will take place. For example, actions of the attributes of actions, muqallibul qulub, the one who turned the hearts. Okay, wa muqallibul qulub. If you said, yeah, well, by the muqallibul qulub, by the one who turns the hearts, then that's an attribute of Allah Azza wa Jalla. If you have intended Allah, then it is an oath. Can I make an oath by the Quran? Abu Hanifa says, no, it is not an oath. But it is an oath because it's Quran is one of his attributes. Quran is the words of Allah. And the words of Allah is an attribute. Okay? So when we say that we are allowed to make isti'adha by the attributes of Allah, a'udhu bi wajhik wa sultaniq, by I seek refuge in your face, that's an attribute, by your dominion, by your sovereignty. Okay, a'udhu bi kalimatillah, a'udhu bi ridaka min sakhatik, seek refuge in your pleasure from your anger. All of that you're making here is taking refuge, which is like an oath, from one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So making an oath by Quran, yes. But when we say making the oath by the Quran is not to put the mushaf and then you put your hands on top of it and then you say by the Quran. No, you say by the Quran, because that thing has been taken by from the non-Muslims. It's not from the Muslims. There is no such thing. You put the book here. It's the non-Muslims. When somebody wants to take a position of a leader, they put in the book that he believes, put his hands like, let's say you go to court as well. You know? They put your hands on that. We don't do that. I went to court twice for something to do with the speeding and all of that. I won the court, alhamdulillah, I won the case. They told me, and the lady who is the cleric, she said, we got the Quran, so you could make an oath, and it's been clothed, because they know that the Quran has to be respected, not to be touched by her, because she's not a Muslim, you understand me? So they respect that, so it could be clothed. I said to her, my dear, whether it's clothed or not clothed, I don't make an oath except by saying the word. So I could just say the word but without touching, because this is, in my religion, it's a bid'ah. In my way, oh, she didn't know that. She never had that. Heard that as well. So I said, I swear, I do solemnly, when he said solemnly, just say that. So making your hand. As for the making of the oath on the mushaf, listen, this mushaf is the book that contains the Quran. The Quran is the words of Allah. Do you understand me? Mushaf is the book. Mushaf, it could be Quran, it could be Mushaf for something else. It could be Mushaf for songs, a book. But when you say Mushaf, the book said Quran. So if he said by the Mushaf, if he meant the Quran, it's an oath. If he didn't mean the Quran, that's shirk. You're not making an oath by Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? So, because the Mushaf means the papers. So if you meant the papers, that's not Quran. Suhuf, Mushaf, Suhuf Ibrahim or Musa, scrolls, papers. But you meant that what is in the Mushaf, that is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. From the oaths, they call it swearing. Swearing here is not swearing at someone, swearing means swearing by Allah, oaths. From the swearings as well, the oaths Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to us as well, that if a person made a yameen in the following manner, he said, عَلَيَّ الطَّلَقْ بِالْحَرَامِ. These words are commonly used in the Arab world. عَلَيَّ الطَّلَقْ, upon me the divorce. I think we talked about that when we talked about the chapter about marriage and divorce. Upon me the divorce, that I'm going to go to such and such place. Upon me the divorce, if... And I'm going to go ride from here. I'm going to go to such and such place, or I'm going to prevent you from coming to my house. هي علي الطلاق. It is not making a conditional divorce. No. Conditional divorce is like this. You say to the wife, if you come out of this house, if you come out of these doors, you are divorced. If she comes out, she's divorced. That's called طلاق معلق. Suspended, hooked, طلاق. It's طلاق, divorce, which is based upon if she had crossed the borderline that you have made. So if you come out of this door, you are طلاق. You're divorced. She'll be divorced if she came out. Or if you went out tonight, out of this door, you'll be divorced. If you came inside such and such place, somebody's place, you're divorced. That's different from upon me, the divorce. That is an oath. Okay? It's an oath and it is valid. It's not shirk. عَلَيَّ الطَّلَاقِ. Okay? So it is not divorce. Also, عَلَيَّ الْحَرَامِ. Okay? So they're making طَلَاق, which is, this is basically the scholars have made it, Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah, as to be as part of the oaths. طيب. أوز يا أخواني, when you make an oath, make it easy for the people. Don't say words people don't understand. Like there are some words that I'm going to use them, and they are oaths, but they don't understand. For example, لعمر الله لعمرك إنهم لفي سكرتهم يعمهون, سورة الحجر. لعمرك, لعمرك is an oath, but not everybody understands that it's an oath. لعمر الله لنقتلنك أو لنقتلنا أو لنقتلا. This is an oath. We mentioned the hadith. Also, عهد الله, the covenant of Allah. وعهد الله, by the covenant of Allah. That's an oath. إن الذين يشترون بعهد الله ثمنا وأيمانهم ثمنا قليلا. It's purchased with their oaths and the covenant of Allah, cheap things. So they use the oath to make, you know, money out of that. So this is an ayah which was revealed regarding a person who had made an oath onto something which was a lie. So ahdullah. Also qasam say, you say qasam say, aqsam to qasam say, qas as well, qasam. So you qasam say, khalas, that's been an oath. And that is regarded by the brothers from Pakistan, in speaking the Urdu, is to be an oath. As for ashhadu, I testify, if he intended to be an oath, it becomes an oath. But most of the scholars, they say, it is not an oath unless with an intention. You have to have an intention. Aymullah, also an intention, is an oath. Wa aymullah, Prophet said, by aymullah, by Allah, if Fatima is to steal, I will cut off her hand. طيب, we've got two things to tackle here before we go ahead. Number one, Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, he number of times he makes an oath by other than himself. For example, he said, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَى وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَى. Okay, by the sun and by the moon, شَمْسِ. So by the sun and whoever created it, شَمْسِ وَضُحَى, and by the light of it, وَضُحَى وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, and by the moon which comes when the sun disappears. So he's mentioning Allah Azza wa Jal, وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ, by the fig and by the olive. Can I see, I say these oaths? No. It's only for Allah. And Allah is making an oath by his creation to show their importance. He is the one who is allowed, because he's Allah Azza wa Jal. We are not allowed because Allah did not allow us to use by the fig and by the sun and by the moon. Okay? And by the day of resurrection, we cannot say that. Second issue is that there's a hadith, which is also in Sahih al-Imam Muslim. At the end of it, one of the narrations is called Aflaha wa Abi. This is a Bedouin man, came to the Prophet ﷺ. He said to him, Messenger of Allah, what is upon me from the Islam? Just give me, you know, small points. That's what he meant, small points. He said, five daily prayers, except you ought to make voluntary. Okay, what about another one? He said, fasting Ramadan. He said, you want to do voluntary. Zakah, give the money, except you want to do voluntary sadaqah. Hajj, except you want to do voluntary. So he said, by Allah, I'm going to do only the obligatory. I'm not going to do any voluntary. And he left. Prophet he said, aflaha wa abi. He's successful and by his father. By his father is an oath. He's successful by his father. So here is an oath by Adhan Allah. Shirk. It cannot be from the Prophet of Allah who had told off Umar al-Khattab. And he said, don't make an oath by your father and grandfather. So what is the way to direct this hadith, which we have it in Sahih, Imam Muslim, that little phrase which is Aflaha wa abi. Not all the religion has that one. So the interpretation is, let's say, some scholars say this is before the prohibition that the Prophet has been told by the Almighty. It was allowed at the beginning. Also another interpretation for this, that this is the Arab on their tongue. Like for example, Prophet a number of times he says to the companion if he did something wrong, or he said something outrageous, he would say, Thakilatka ummu, may your mother lose you. He's not asking Allah to make his mother to, you know, to lose him. That means to drop dead. He's not, this is an Arab saying, but what are you talking about? So they said, Thakilatka ummu. So if you translate in English, may your mother lose you, Prophet is harsh. You know, saying, asking death to that person. No, that's an Arab saying. It means you're talking nonsense. Thakilatka ummu. Same thing they said, this is wa aflaha wa abi. It does not mean oath, it means something that you will be very good and your father will be happy for you. And I bet you they're going to do it. It's like saying to the Bedouin, you're not going to do it. Aflaha wa abi. You know, aflaha. Also, another one, which is that is tasheef, meaning that that word was not correctly being documented. Okay? Aflaha wa abi is not being documented properly. But the correct opinion of all of those three opinions, the fourth one, which I haven't said yet. And the Sheikh al-Albani, rahimahullah, he better relax. He said, this addition, which is Sahih Muslim, is shadha. It's not sahih. All the narrations did not mention it, except for that narration. Sheikh al-Albani, through the rules of hadith and narrations, he had verified and established that that one is not authentic. Alhamdulillah, it's not authentic. I don't need all these interpretation, 1, 2, 3. So it's not authentic. And you'll find it in Silsila Hadith al-Da'ifa, 4992. Da'ifa, 4992. But now coming back to the halif bi ghayri Allahi shirk. I'm gonna also, he just mentioned here hadith of Anas. Who is the one who is making an oath by the might of Allah? Is the fire, isn't it? Isn't it? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, he would put his foot onto the fire, and the fire would say, stop, 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 us, finish, I'm filled up. Wa izzatika, by your might. I mean, my might, I'm asking you, by your might, to stop. And then the fire will be folded and khalas will be stopped. So we have, this is from the fire. We want a hadith from the Prophet or from a prophet, from a human being. Let's just give you one, which is hadith Abi Huraira radiallahu an, that talks about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, by the way. That the last, it's a long hadith, the last person comes out from the hellfire. Okay? And he's been put into the, he's from the Muslims. Mu'min, last person has been charcoal, put in the water of the hayat, is called life water, which is from the Jannah, and then become up and is a human being. And then he will be brought out of the hellfire, and then he will be given a tree to look at it. Oh Lord, just give me to that shade of the tree, and I will not ask you something else. And in that he said, wa izzatika, by your might, I'm not going to ask you. Allah knows he's going to ask you. So when you go to the shade tree, he gives him another tree, bigger and massive. Just Lord, just give me two other three. Woe to you, the son of Adam. Allah Azza wa Jalla say, woe to you, the son of Adam. I cannot trust you. I'm just giving you that and you're asking again. So he asked to go there and Allah would give him. Then he's close to paradise and he could hear the water. You know, it's like, you know, imagine that you are outside the funfair and you want to go to the funfair. But it's nothing to do with Jannah. But everybody, the children will find it like Jannah for them. They want to jump in. They want to go inside, behind the walls. So this person just hears Jannah. Oh Lord, can you just make me to enter Jannah? And I will not ask you anything else. Just to get me closer to the Jannah. And he's asking, wa izzatika, la as'aluka shay ghayrahu abad. Nothing will ask. And Allah Azza wa Jalla will get him closer. Until he will ask to get in. And then Allah, he says to him, get in. And then you say to him, wish. Come on, give a wish. So he starts Now, each person who comes from a different type of world, so if he's from the type of the world of the Prophet of Allah, that last person, he could be asking now, Lord, I want the red camels and such and such. If you are from this era, I want a Bugatti car and Bugini and Porsche and, you know, all of these luxury. If you are from the, maybe in the future, you're going to become a spaceship. And I don't know what's going to happen in the future. So each person will ask according to the life of his time, which life he had lived. So Allah will give, he said, okay, all of that is for you and 10 times it's like. 10 times it's like. So whatever you ask him, 10 times. This person, he thinks he's the best of all people. He doesn't know that he is what? The minimum of paradise. That's why there is no envy. Because he thinks he's the best. Nobody can have like him. Nobody. Because he thinks he's the best. So no envy, no envy, hasad. So he goes to another palace. Oh, I wish that palace to be burnt. And there's no such thing in the paradise. There's nothing. وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِيرٍ. We're going to pluck out from their hearts all to do with envy and grudge. That's before you enter paradise. So this is as well, he's saying, وَعِزَّتِكَ. Also, we have another hadith from Abu Hurairah, the Prophet, he said, Ayyub alayhi salam. Ayyub, he said, while he was, and this is Bukhari and Muslim again, Sahih Bukhari Muslim, he was making a, bathing himself, يغتسل, washing himself, and he was naked. So some golden locust, but it's gold, okay, it had started to fall down. So Ayyub, he started taking with his, you know, with his clothes, more gold. It's gold. Imagine how much locust, jarad, you know, so look, gold, gold, gold. So Allah Azza wa Jal called upon Ayyub. Didn't I give you more satisfaction? Aren't you satisfied? I've given you satisfaction from what you have just seen now. So he says, Qala bala. I said, yes, O Lord, you have given me. And he said, Wa izzatika, by your might, you've given me satisfaction. Walakin, but la ghina an barakatik. I have no way to be satisfied from gaining more barakah from you. Do you understand? It's more barakah. Yes, you're giving me satisfaction, but I cannot stop be satisfied from your barakah. Now we're going to go to the halif بغير الله شرك. Make an oath by Allah.
Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrated that he heard the Messenger of Allah
saying,
whoever has sworn by other than Allah has truly committed disbelief or associated partner with Allah. Additionally, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam
said, if one of you swore and said while swearing, I swear by Allah,
which is the goddess or the god that has been used at the time of Quraysh now.
He should then say, I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah.
La ilaha illallah.
If someone says to his companion, come, let us gamble, he should then give charity.
Right. We need to, first of all, he said, the Prophet of Allah, man halafa bi ghayri Allah, he made an oath by other than Allah, he made kufr or shirk. Now, if this person had meant by his oath to say that Allah is equal to that person or whatever thing that he had made an oath with, then he is making major shirk. You understand that? So if he had said, by my father, by my mother, by my wife, by the house of such and such, by the, he made an oath by other than Allah. If he meant whatever he made an oath with, that that thing, that person is equal or greater than Allah, then he's making a major shirk, which will take him outside the fold of Islam. But if, which is mostly the cases, is always like that. But if he did not mean it, it's only a shirk in his what? In his tongue. So it is minor shirk. But remember, minor shirk is the postage for the major shirk. Once you go to the minor shirk, you know, somehow you're bound to go to the major one. And some of the scholars, they said, like Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, minor shirks will not be forgiven. You're going to be punished for that. It's not like the major sins, like fornication. So to make a minor shirk is greater in sin than fornicating, than drinking alcohol. It's a minor shirk. Because the scholars had debated regarding the minor shirk. Is it going to be forgiven? Because Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ وَيَغْفِرُ. Allah does not forgive the person who is committing shirk with him. So this one could be including major and minor. Major one, outside the fold of Islam, eternal hellfire. Minor one, he will be punished, but he will be later on, because of his tawheed, coming out of the fire. But it's going to be punishable. Some scholars say, they said, no, it's only the major shirk. The minor shirk is still under the will of Allah. That means if you are muwahid, monotheistic, you have minor shirk, like by the words, like this one, or the one who put talisman, and he, you know, he does not say the talisman, or the, you know, whatever is ta'aweez, it's going to be benefited beside Allah. But he says, Allah will benefit me through this. That's minor shirk. If he said, this one will benefit me regardless of Allah, that's major shirk. So if this person had monotheism, they said the scholars, and he did this minor shirk, Allah might forgive him and not to punish him in that. So it's under the will. Others said, no, it's not under the will. Allah will punish him straight away, because he has to be punished for that minor shirk. طيب. The thing here, that if somebody said, by my father, he made an oath by Allah. Now, it says here, if I made this oath, by my father, I'm not going to come out of these doors. If I said, by Allah, I'm not going to come out of these doors, and I went out of these doors, then I have to expiate for my oath. But now I said, by my father, I am not going to go through these doors, but I went through these doors. Am I going to expiate? No. Expiate for what? Father is nothing. It's to you something. It's nothing. It's not God. Because you cannot make an expiation for something that you're going to make him equal to Allah. You only expiate because you violated an oath to Allah. You have made it in Allah. So you cannot give some sort of importance to that thing. You have made a shirk. You have to say astaghfirullah. So whether you went through the door, you did not go through the door, there is no such thing called expiation. Al-Hanif. Cannot make kafara. So if this person had made a kafara for something is wrong, cannot make kafara, is to make to repent, because you cannot make absolving, or you cannot make majestic, or make, saying that it's a majesty, this like Allah Azza wa Jal, that father of yours, or whatever you have made an oath with. Cannot give him any importance like the Almighty. طيب. He says in this hadith of Abu Hurairah that he who made an oath by saying Wallat, not by his father, by Allat, by the Uzza, by any goddess, he said, let him say La ilaha illallah. There is no God worthy of worship except for Allah. So this is making an oath by a false God. So he said, by Krishna, by Buddha, by Jesus, do you understand me? You have made an oath other than Allah, then you have to say what? La ilaha illallah. You have what to say? La. You're returning back to Islam. La ilaha illallah. He had said to his friend, let's go and gamble, then let him expiate by Ibn Sadaqah. So when do you say by Jesus, by Buddha, by Krishna, by whatever? First of all, you have to repent to Allah, and also to say, expiate by saying, La ilaha. If you say, by my father, you say, astaghfirullah, for the shirk. Okay? And there is, in both cases, there is no such thing, kafara, expiation. Right. Now, also, we come to a doubtful matter that we need to tackle it. Father.
A source of confusion and its clarification. Some people do not swear by Allah, and as they fear that they would be lying, what Allah has said.
وَلَا تَجْعَلُوا اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ Surah Al-Baqarah 2-4.
And make not Allah's name an excuse in your oaths. The response to this is found in what Misal ibn Khidam narrated from Wabara ibn Abdul Rahman.
Wabara ibn Abdul Rahman, he said, Abdullah ibn
Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Masud said, for me to falsely swear by Allah is more beloved to me than truthfully swearing by other than Allah. On the other hand...
Did you understand the statement of Abdullah ibn Umar? Listen to this. This is his faqih. He said, if I had a choice to make an oath by Allah, yet I'm a liar. And another choice to make an oath by other than Allah, but I'm truthful. Which choice he will take? Again. He said, I've had only two choices. To choose one of them. Either to make an oath by Allah, but I'm lying. By Allah, I have done this, and I haven't done this, I'm a liar. And the other choice is say, by other than Allah, to something which you have done correctly. By other than Allah, by my father, I have done my homework. Which one of the choice is less sinful? Which one of the choice Allah will take? Which one? Is it by Allah when I'm lying, or by other than Allah, but I'm truthful? By Allah, it's less sinful. Because by other than Allah is shirk. Even if it's truthful. See, if I said by Allah, I've done my homework, and I haven't done my homework, okay? Giving hints out. By Allah, I've done my homework, and he hasn't done my homework. It's less sinful, but it's not as sinful as the shirk. That's what he means. As for the ayah now, the verse, fadal.
On the other hand, the meaning of the verse, as Ibn Kathir has mentioned, is explained by Ibn Abbas, who said, do not make your swearing an excuse not to do what is good. Instead, expiate for your oath and do that which is good. Ibn Kathir then noted, this is the view of Masruq.
Shabi Ibrahim al-Nakhai, Mujahid Tawus, Sayyid Jubair al-Atta, wa Ikrim al-Makhul al-Zahid, wa al-Hasan wa Qatada wa Qatad al-Hiyya al-Rawi. We have to send him because maybe you're going to struggle with the name. والربيع بن أنس والضحاك وعطاء الخرساني والسدي والسدي رحمهم الله. May Allah mercy upon them. Coming back now. So the ayah says, وَلَا تَجْعَلُ اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ. If you look at it like this, you might interpret it in the following way. That means do not make oath by Allah. Do not make Allah into the oath of yours. But it's not correct. Allah ibn Abbas, he had said, what is the meaning of this? Allah ibn Abbas also, he had mentioned the story behind this, what has happened. That a person who has made an oath to do or not to do something, then he realized that whatever he's made an oath to do or not to do is not good. So the ayah says, do not make your oath by Allah which you have done to do something or not to do it, and then later on you find something which is 100% better. Don't make this oath of Allah to stop you from not to fulfill the oath. Do you understand that? So by Allah, I am going to travel tomorrow to Birmingham. Then I found out if I go to Birmingham, I'm going to be troubled with my wife. But here I've made an oath by Allah. So shall I go and make my wife, you know, be troubled with me or something? Or shall I just violate this oath and expiate? Do you understand me? And expiate. Which one is better? Allah says, don't make this oath to stop you from doing which is better. So if you made an oath and you thought that this oath to do something is going to be good, but later on you found it's not going to be, consequences are not good. So don't make Allah's oath to be stopping you from violating the oath and expiating and do what you want to do. So don't go to Birmingham and satisfy your wife, for example. So this is the correct meaning of that. وَلَا تَجْعَلُ اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ. Yes, there is a hadith which talks about that, an ayat as well, to make sure that you don't make a lot of oaths. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, وَحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ. Surah Al-Ma'idah. وَحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ. And keep your oath. Don't make the oath. وَلَا تُطِعْ كُلَّ حَلَّافٍ مَهِينٍ. Oh Muhammad, do not follow all of those people who are just making an oath for you. And he is maheen, humiliated. So this person who is making halif all the time, or that haqq and baatil, because when the person start making an oath, like for example, he's selling his laptop, he's selling his car, by Allah, this car is immaculate. By Allah, this laptop will solve your problem. By Allah, and everything by Allah. So in his heart, there will be not a place for the reverence and the fear of Allah when he makes an oath. Do you understand me? He's watering down his oath. That's what is not allowed. To water down the oath. So that is why it is disliked to make an oath, not prohibited, disliked to make an oath in every time you make a merchandise. Prophet said, Al-Halifu man baqa'atun lis-sil'ah mamhaqatun lil-barakah. To make an oath or selling an item, it will make it sellable, but it will remove the barakah. And of course,
This is halif is for the sake of the ones who are يعني Muslims. The non-Muslim, they don't care whether you're going to make an oath or not because they don't believe you. Okay? And talk about the halif that you are the Muslim. They will say to you, by Allah, Allah, this is. And he will be, especially if you're a sheikh and you look, mashallah, truthful. You say, by Allah, he will take it. By Allah, my car, I'm selling you 100%. Following day, you find lots of sorts of problems which he knew about. That's a'udhu billah. So don't make an oath unless you need to do so. طيب. Now we come into the following title. طبعا.
Whoever swears by religion other than Islam. Thabit ibn al-Dahhak said that the Messenger of Allah had said, whoever intentionally and falsely swears by religion other than Islam, then he is as he has said. Abdullah ibn Buraydah narrated from his father that the Messenger of Allah said, As for whoever says, I'm innocent of Islam.
That means I'm free of Islam, not innocent of Islam. I have got nothing to do with Islam.
If he has said it falsely, it is still as he has said. If he has said it truthfully, then he will not return to Islam flawless.
I have to explain this properly so you could understand. What is the title is all about? A person is saying, Ana mush Muslim if this car is not good. I am not going to be a Muslim if the car is not good. Do you understand me? It's making an oath by other than Islam. I'm a Jew. I'm a Christian if I never visited such and such place. Do you understand me? He's making an oath by saying that he's outside the fold of Islam. Got nothing to do with Islam if I did not break your car. It's not something to the future now. I'm not going to smash your face, for example. I'm not going to be a Muslim. That's making an oath by other than the religion of Islam. So this is nothing to do with making an oath by other than Allah. No, different. So this is now, this Prophet Muhammad, he said, he who had made such an oath, okay, then he is like what he had said. Meaning, and the scholars, by the way, differ regarding this oath. Does it take place or not? Even if he's truthful or not truthful. Is it an oath or not? It's not like the one who says, by my father. That's not an oath. This one, is it an oath or not? The correct opinion, it is an oath. Because it's to do with the deen. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said that this person, he had made something entailed upon his connection to the Almighty. I have nothing to do with the religion of Allah if this such thing isn't going to happen or happened. Okay, so this is what the iman is all about. So all of it is about this. This is the oath to link things to Allah Azza wa Jal, either by Allah or dissociating yourself from Allah. Do you understand me? So that is an oath. And this is the reality of, actually, this is the whole thing all about the oath itself. So if you have made such an oath and you don't mean to exalt that religion that you are saying, then it's an oath. But if you came out of it, if you are a liar, then you are a liar. But if you did not, you're not a liar. Say, I'm Jewish, I am going to be, if I don't really smash your face. And you want to smash yourself. And you fulfill that. Okay? You're not going to go back to the Islam with the same rank as you are because you've said a word which is not good. Okay? And if you're a liar, you're a liar. But so this person, if he said it, but if he said it while he is exalting, he's speaking about that religion with pride and he loves it, then he's outside the fold of Islam. That's different. Okay, so if he said, I am got nothing to do with Allah, I'm an atheist if you don't do this, and he loves atheism, he put atheism is equal to Islam, he's outside the fold of Islam. So it is shirk. Whether it's truthful or not, that is shirk. So the hadith is telling us, don't make such an oath. Even if you are not making that the religion is to be equal to the religion of Islam, or that God is to be equal to God of Allah, but don't make that. Now, we're going to go to another type of topic, which we're going to leave that one. But we want to say to you, it's not allowed for you as well to make an oath by the amana. You know the amana? Wal amana. In Arabic, wal amana. By the amana, by the trust. We say, don't make that. Because the Prophet, he said, man halafa bil amana, who had made an oath by the trust, is not from us. Laysa minna. Following that, inshallah, I mean, next week, bi-idhnillah, man hudifa lahu billahi falyarrah. He who has been made an oath to him by Allah, let him what? Accept. What does it say in the title?
One who is asked to swear by Allah should be satisfied with that.
I'm not sure that the title has been translated. No, no. If somebody had given you an oath by Allah, you should believe him, you should accept it. Does that give that the same meaning? No, it doesn't. So it's wrong a translation. Do you understand? If somebody gave you an oath, by Allah, I did not take your stuff. By Allah, I did not see him. By, you should believe him. Okay, that's what it means. That's what the title is all about. Okay, we have, alhamdulillah, finished now. We've got, okay, so we, from 7 to 8 the class, but don't mind, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Come on.
Okay, just two questions that came to light, and the sisters asked one. You know, when you mentioned, Sheikh, about the Qasam in the Urdu language,
Qasam say,
but you don't mention the name of Allah, so how is that an oath?
No problem. If you said Uqsam, because the person he means by Allah.
Okay.
So it's known to be a...
Because the intention.
Yes, the intention. It's in the... Okay. Yeah, Uqsam, Qasam.
And the one when you touch the Quran, if like someone, I mean, it happens...
The Mus'haf.
It happens in the South Asian subcontinent a lot. They say, well, if you're not lying, touch the Quran.
That's all of it nonsense.
Is that an oath or not, if you touch the Quran?
No, touching the Quran is not an oath. The wordings is the same.
And the other one is...
You say by the Quran, it's an oath, except Abu Hanifa, he said it happened, no.
And by people sometimes use the phrase, by my mother's life.
A'udhu billah, that's shirk. The worst of this is that when the person says to another person, by Allah, I didn't do it. Another person looking at him. By the honor of my sister. My sister, she's a fornicator, if I'm alive. Then he will believe. A'udhu billah. So when he made shirk to him, he believed him. Do you have this in Pakistan?
My mother's life is common.
No, in our country, no. Arz ukhti means by the honor of my sister. I mean, my sister is a fornicator, if I'm a liar. Then the person will believe. A'udhu billah, shirk. So you only believe when he made shirk. So you don't believe him when you hear about Allah, Allah, by Allah. So as by the honor of your mother is something known, yeah?
And the sisters asked, what is the strongest oath to make, as in the phrase?
There's no such thing as the strongest oath. There's such thing, it is to, which is, how is your situation? So always you can say by Allah. But some people, some communities, they will be, for example, using, like the time of the Prophet of Allah, whenever he wants to make an oath to the assembly of Quraysh, he says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ, by the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad, that's Allah. So the people of Quraysh will understand, oh, by the one in whose soul, in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad, is the one who's controlling the life and the death of Muhammad. So it makes more of impact in the hearts of the people. So it depends upon the environment, the place, the people, and so on and so forth.
And the sisters are saying, there's a saying among young people, when they say, swear down or say mums. Never heard of this, but...
Say swear down and what?
Save. Swear down or say mums.
Save mums?
Say mums. Say mums.
Say mums. What does that mean?
Young people say, say mums.
Is that right?
Have you heard of this?
So explain to us, what does say mums mean? A'udhu billah, that's shirk as well.
It's a shirk.
So we're going to teach that to your children. So you came to the class, mashallah, you benefit. Tell the other children, haram. What do you mean mums? No mums, no mamus, no sisters.
So basically, they have to, if they say it, they have to do tawbah, basically. Yeah?
To be ashamed, astaghfirullah. Yes.
Okay.
So can't make an oath by honors of mothers. Very good question. Relax. Anything? Al-Fadhali Ahmed. I think Ahmed is not allowed to speak. Right. Tawbah. Yeah, you're in control now. Quickly,
we've got to leave. Questions for you about Dhul Hijjah. The first one is, if a son is slaughtering on behalf of his sick father, Is the son allowed to cut his nails and hair and take from his skin?
It's only the one who is spending the money, who's in charge of the udhiyah. So if it's the father, regardless who slaughters it. So if it's slaughtering on his behalf, father's alive or dead?
No, he's just sick.
Yeah, sick, the means. So if he's in charge of the udhiyah, the father, then father is to abstain. If he's not in charge, it's the son who pays it and everything, then it's the son who's abstaining. If both of them are in sharing of that one, then both of them will abstain. Okay, second question, Shammam. Shammam, sur'a.
Assalamu alaikum,
Shammam.
Assalamu alaikum. When it comes to making
noise behind you, there's noise behind you, Shammam.
Yeah, sorry, Shekhan, I'm actually at an airport right now. Can you hear me now?
Okay, I could hear you now.
Yeah, so when it comes to making an oath other than Allah, but the oath still being an oath that stands, meaning if you don't do it, you have to pay the kafara, what is the discerning factor between when we accept it or when we don't?
What do you mean by accept it? So for example, you made an oath to lift up this mobile. You did not lift it up. That means you have to expiate.
So what if I said I swear on my mother's life that I will lift up this phone? Does the if I don't lift up the phone, do I still have to expiate?
This is shirk, akhi.
Would I still have to expiate?
No, we said you don't expiate. I think you're not with us.
Okay.
You're not. See the class. We said it's not an oath to say by my father and my father. It's just an istighfar to Allah. طيب.
Last one. If somebody gives the udhiyah, so on behalf of their wife or their children, so they do like four or five, do the women also not able to do anything?
I don't understand the question. So
let's say a man gives five udhiyahs.
So five udhiyahs is him, the one who's going to be abstained from them.
Just him, not the rest.
Just him, because he's the one providing the udhiyah. Nobody else. And he should not be providing for each one because only one for enough of everybody.
One, give sadaqah.
Give sadaqah, but not on behalf. You can give sadaqah, you give it. But don't say, this is on behalf of my wife, this is my child. You give it on yourself. Yourself, you give it. And your children, they are with you. But you give it to them on behalf of theirs. They are dependent upon you. And you are the one who is independent. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Subhanakallah bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu. So I get down, please.